Hello, my friends. Happy holidays, first of all. And remember, the word holiday comes from the word holy day, holy day. And holiness is not self-righteous morality or cunning hypocrisy. Holiness is all-inclusiveness and related to the word wholeness, healing, health. Health and healing are the return of the memory of wholeness, the one reality in which we are differentiated minds, differentiated bodies, etc. But today's post actually is inspired by something I got on Quora this morning, Q-U-O-R-A. It's a website where people ask experts questions. And unfortunately, when I took my notes, I didn't copy the name of the questioner or the expert who answered it. So apologies both to the person who asked the question and to the expert who answered it, obviously a theoretical physicist. And the question concerns the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in describing what we call the physical universe. So let me actually read from my notes and then we'll discuss this. Very, very interesting discussion. In his famous essay, The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Sciences, the Nobel Prize winning physicist Eugene Wigner wrote that the correspondence between pure mathematics and the natural world was something bordering on the mysterious. There is, he said, no rational explanation for it. Now, at the end of this conversation, I'll give you the rational explanation for it. But let me continue with this query and the answer. It makes sense to say that basic mathematics was developed to describe things in the everyday world. We can understand the origin of things like counting and addition, and how to calculate area. However, as Wigner goes on to argue, this simple explanation fails to account for so much of what we see. The work of professional mathematicians often involves incredible ingenuity and extraordinary feats of logic. Some theorems and proofs take years to work out, and yet astonishingly, many of the most brilliant and insanely abstract concepts turn out to model real-world phenomena perfectly. They fit like lock and key. The math and the physical world fit like lock and key, the phenomena of the physical world. Consider this. Consider for a moment just how extraordinary this is. We have this set of things our minds seem to have produced in an abstract, non-physical realm of ideas. And we have another category or set of things we'll call things that the universe does. Then, as history unfolds, we discover that there is exact correspondence between various mathematical concepts and the things the universe does. There's a kind of remarkable overlap between what's going on in our minds and what's going on out there. As we'll see, there's no out there. And very often the math was worked out long before we went looking out in the world for a fit. To quote Wigner, it's difficult to avoid the impression that a miracle confronts us here. Yes, existence is a miracle, but we call it a miracle when we don't have an explanation. When we have an explanation, these days, we call it science, even though the explanation may be wrong. So let me go on. Miracle confronts us here. This is remarkable. The things the universe appears to be doing at the level of physics is mirrored in the mathematical realm. The universe, it seems, is behaving in accordance with the products of the mind. I would say the universe is... And so is the mind a product of something deeper that we'll call awareness. But let's keep going. Is mathematics something humans invented? If the answer is yes, how did something that is purely an artifact of mind get out there in the wild? How does it make it into the very fabric of the external world? See, wrong assumptions. Around every corner in physics, we find concepts no one thought would ever show up in the familiar world, but they do. Crazy, non-intuitive principles and things no one ever dreamed would leave the pages of mathematics journals turn out to be exactly what is needed to describe what the world is doing. You could almost put this into a syllogism. Premise one, mathematical entities are the products of the mind. Premise number two, the universe behaves according to mathematical entities. Conclusion, therefore, the universe behaves according to the products of the mind. But maybe we've got all this wrong. Maybe mathematical entities are not actually produced by our minds. Yet, if we change our story and accept that mathematics is somehow really out there, this whole concept of out there is misleading. But anyway, yet if we change our story and accept that mathematics is somehow really out there, really existing in a humanity-independent way, we have not managed to escape from the conclusion. In fact, if it's discovered and not invented, the mystery is even more profound. Now we have this realm of abstract ideas and relationships, an infinite logical landscape, which we have direct access to through our minds. And yet, while non-physical, somehow this realm guides the behavior of things in the physical world. It seems inescapable. Something mind-like is running the world, providing the framework, the tracks for physical reality to run on. Einstein himself struggled to explain how this could be. How is it that mathematics, being, after all, a product of human thought, now we're quoting Einstein, how is it that mathematics, being, after all, a product of human thought, is so admirably appropriate to the subjects of reality, to the objects of reality? I repeat that. How is it that mathematics, being, after all, a product of the human thought, this is Einstein, is so admirably appropriate to the objects of reality? Is human reason then without experience merely by taking thought able to fathom the properties of real things? Okay, Einstein, that's the quote. If anyone in history had a right to comment on this issue, it was Einstein. He, relying more or less entirely on thought experiments, was able to unlock some of the best secrets of the universe. He himself found this astonishing, saying famously, the most incomprehensible thing about the world is that it is comprehensible. It's not, but let's go on. Why would what's really out there have correspondence meaningfully to what was going on in his mind? Einstein spoke reverently, even religiously, of the experiences he had in beholding the radiant beauty that shone forth when he sought to peer into the mysteries of the universe. He was satisfied, he said, with a sense of the marvelous structure of existence and his humble attempt to understand even a tiny portion of the reason that manifests itself in nature. Speaking of mathematics in particular, Einstein wrote, "Pure mathematics is, in its way, the poetry of logical ideas. In this effort toward logical beauty, spiritual formulas are discovered, necessary for the deeper penetration into the laws of nature. The more you think about it, the more remarkable it becomes. How is it that with a little more than some deep reflection, a man sitting alone in a Swiss patent office was able to grasp the profoundest secrets of space and time? What does it say about the universe that pure thought is able to disclose many of its deepest enigmas?" The philosopher David Wood brings this into sharp focus. Before you knew that the universe is governed by elegant mathematical equations, Would you have had reason to await that? Would you expect the universe to be like that? Of course not. Mathematics is a language. The universe is operating according to language. This should not be at all surprising for those who believe in God. It should be horrifying to atheists, because that is the last thing you should expect. So that's the end of the query and the answer, with apologies that I didn't name the questioner, nor did I name the expert who answered the question. So here is how you can solve this conundrum. There is no physical universe. What we call the physical universe, including that part of the physical universe which we call our body, is a human construct, for modifications of consciousness as perceptions, images, feelings, thoughts. I've said this many times, but it takes many iterations to say the same thing in many ways to actually finally get it. There is no physical universe, just like there is no physical body, period. What we call the universe, physical universe, is a human interpretation, a human construct, a human model for modifications of consciousness as sensations, images, feelings, and thoughts. So this is what appears as the human universe, human physical universe, not that of any other species. The universe as experienced in human awareness, which is non-local, by the way. And everything is non-local, even though it appears local. Mind, body, objects, all non-local. That's another discussion. However, what we call the physical universe is what appears on the screen of consciousness as a pattern generated through modalities of knowing and experience, which are essentially sensations, which are essentially modifications of awareness, or chit. That's what it's called in Sanskrit. So let's dispense with the idea that there's a physical body and there's a physical universe. Although what appears as the physical body and the physical universe go together. Okay, this body and all this goes together. This body, your body, all this goes together. And they're all fluctuations of awareness. Okay, so now let's put that aside. No physical universe. Then we come to math. Math also appears on the screen of consciousness and therefore is a modified form of consciousness. It's a language, as I read, and a human language for human experiences. And therefore, both math and universe are human constructs. They're modifications of non-local awareness appearing as the correspondence between mathematics and the universe. No physical universe. Both are human constructs, mathematics and the physical universe. Furthermore, even that is, in a sense, a magical lie, because we assume that the appearance of the universe, the picture of the universe, is the human look of it, not a crocodile look of it, or a butterfly look of it, or a snake look of it, or an alligator look of it, or a dolphin look of it, or an insect with 100 eyes look of it. Why is this important? Well, it is important because it leads to very fundamental solutions for cosmic conundrums like space, time, energy, information, matter, all human constructs, all your creation. In other words, you are the universe. You are the universe, not the body-mind. You. That is the same as the projection of the universe, and the same as mathematics. Mathematics, the body-mind, and the universe are one integrated process in consciousness. And you are that. Tattvamasi, Satchitanand, Aham Brahmasmi. Okay. Now I'm going to do another post following this, which will share with you how this has a solution to living in the light, yoga for self-realization, with my yoga teacher, Sarah Plattfinger. Thank you.